Catalysis. Welcome to the Doomsday Report. Now, on this week's episode, we have two-fifths of Catalysis, all the way from Dundee. They're a band that certainly bring the groove. How's it going, guys? Welcome back on the Doomsday Report.
Thank you very much for having us, man. Yeah, we're good. We're good. Just off stage, feeling a little bit
sweaty,
a bit of sore neck.
I don't know about that, sore neck.
We're old.
We're old, man. We did a video for a new song for the new EP at the weekend, and we were talking all week about how we're just slowly recovering.
Yeah.
So it was really good to go upstairs and headbang like fuck for 40 minutes.
2 songs in, I was like, oh, that's that recovery fucking gone. Yeah, exactly.
Now, it's been a long time since I got the chance to chat to you on here. In fact, it was the 2019 final. You was on that before that. But a lot has changed since then, so I'd just like to briefly go over that and see how things are going. Now, the last time we spoke, it was shortly before you announced your European tour.
Yep.
Now, how did that tour go?
Fucking incredible. Was it like the absolute best thing we've ever done as a band? In terms of like the actual shows themselves were great, but the experience.
Yeah, it was the experience.
Like, I don't think any of the guys in the band had ever done like the, you know, traditional, like, you know, when you're 18, do the lads holiday, that. And it was like, I guess like a mixture of getting that aspect, just hanging out with your best friends for a bunch of time, and also playing some awesome shows with, one, some really good bands, two, in really good venues, the standard of the venues was awesome, and three, with awesome promoters who treated us like kings. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, we were arriving at the venue to like full hot catering and stuff, which for a band of our size, you're like, what the fuck? Like,
don't experience that in Scotland.
I guess we didn't really know sort of what to expect, you know?
Especially because I booked a tour. Like, we didn't choose a booking agent or whatever, I did it myself. So, like, you know, I was kind of expecting some of the shows to be a bit Mickey Mouse and a bit dud and whatever. And the first show we got there, first thing that happened, they were like, here's your money for tonight, here's, like, you know, they gave us, like, I guess like you call it a packed lunch or whatever, but it was like, you know, baguettes and all this kind of shit, crisps and what, like, all gave us all that, gave us bottles of water and stuff, to, you know, made sure that we were just properly taken care of, and
helped us,
venue staff helped us load into the venue and stuff. So like the venue we're talking about just now is MCP Apache in Charleroi in Belgium. So shout out to Johan, the promoter, absolute legend.
Yeah,
but you know. We were just treated so fucking well. The difference between, like, and not to diss any Scottish promoters, you know, there's a lot of good promoters out there, like Duncan, who put on tonight's event and stuff. But you know, the shows that you rock up and you get nothing. You know, you go to the bar, you ask for some water, and they fucking try and charge you for a plastic cup to put it in some venues here, you know what I mean? So to be going over and be provided everything we needed, paid, and not just like paid to cover fuel, but like paid handsomely. The first show in Belgium, we sold basically all the merch we took with us, because you know you never want to order too much merch and be left with it. So European tour was awesome.
It was.
We had fucking Circle Pits and Walls of Death and
really
Just the shit that you dream of every time you step on stage here, we actually got there, and it's like, oh.
But we went over primarily because we were doing the aggressive music first, right?
Yeah.
So that was our like main goal. That's where we were traveling, and Drew booked us shows on the way. But like I said, the MCP Apache first show, we rocked up. It was like a sort of garage where you would get your car fixed kind of thing, you know. But he lifted it up. It was this stage that was made with like pallets, you know. And we were like, oh well, this is rough, but it should be good. But by the time they came in and sort of started putting it together, it was an incredible show. Like, unless you said, like, you finish, bam, last chord. The crowd just turned straight to the merch.
We're in the French-speaking part of Belgium, so I'm standing at the merch table and everybody's speaking French at me, and I'm like, fuck.
We've got to give a shout to Gennaro. He's like our sixth member.
He was our fifth member. Pabs is the sixth member.
Pabs is, yeah. But no, yeah, so Gennaro came with us. He was our roadie slash photographer.
Yeah, he's like our Italian
best friend.
He's like our Italian friend who lives in France. So he speaks English, Italian stuff. He was invaluable on that trip because he could communicate. Yeah, he's a very smart man. Good photographer, great person. But yeah, so the European tour was fucking incredible. We're looking at doing another one next year. Put the feelers out. Because it was genuinely, like, it probably didn't cost us that much. You know, we probably overall broke even, which is all you could really want, and the experience was worth it. Now, because of Brexit and stuff, it maybe cost us a little bit more, but
petrol will be like fucking cut our arms and legs off
like,
so we
can that's one of my questions actually. It's like, how much time did you actually spend like traveling on the road itself?
Well, Jude did a good portion of the driving. Like, it was a long way, but we treated it when we went into it. We didn't go into it thinking, oh, hope the shows are good, hope the turnout's good. As you said, it was a total just holiday for us guys, including shows, to get to our destination, which was the fest. We knew the fest was going to be a decent turnout.
Yeah.
But the shows on the way was so well attended, and it, like, you know, I'm not going to repeat what you said, but it was awesome. But the drives were, I slept for most of them, man. Yeah. Like, he did the drives.
The drives were fucking funny as well.
Yeah, him and Cole did most of the driving, like, so.
But yeah, it was awesome.
Now, if you could say, like, one individual favourite part of that tour, what would that be?
Gennaro.
aside from Gennaro being the best human being on the planet, like, just the day before the festival, we played a show in Prague, and in the evening, we went out into the old town of Prague, and it was, like, middle of July, so even at, you know, midnight or whatever, it was like fucking 20 degrees. We're walking about in shorts and t-shirts. You can drink in the street there, so we're just going into random shops, grabbing a couple of beers, you know, walking along, having a drink, having a laugh, just having a fucking good time.
It was probably summer holiday.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And like,
I couldn't have wished for anything more, man.
Yeah, and you know, like, the guys in the band, we've all got jobs. Sean and Carl have got kids and stuff, so a lot of the time we don't get a lot of time to do stuff other than rehearse, play gigs. You know, and so just to have that time hanging out and with, like, no sort of...
With the boys.
Yeah, exactly. It was incredible.
It's important, do you know what I mean? Like, when you're in a band, it's a brotherhood, do you know what I mean? It's important to spend time together. And, like, that's always in the forefront of what we do is like, when you go to practice or whatever you're doing, coming to the gig tonight, the drive through, it's all about connecting and that brotherhood element.
Yeah.
You need that in a band, do you know what I mean? That's the most important vibe.
Oh, you certainly do. Now, during this time, Cole was playing bass as well, weren't he?
It was,
yeah. So 2019, Cole was playing bass. So, you know, when we did the Metal of the Masters final here previously, he was on bass, and then the tour, he was on bass as well. And right up to basically the end of 2019, I think the last show that Cole played on bass might have been when we supported Sacred Reich in the Cat House, which is obviously a great show, big deal and stuff. And even before that show, Cole had been saying that when we were working on the stuff for Connection Lost, sort of, the full length we released in 2020, that he had a lot of ideas for vocals that he wouldn't be able to do if he was playing bass. Mm. So we spoke about getting somebody in. And so, you know, we spoke to a few different people and kind of got messed about a bit by a couple of people and whatnot. So we got a guy in on bass. He joined just after the album was finished being recorded and stuff, so...
No, it was Kenny, yeah.
Yeah.
We're a real tight unit, do you know what I mean? Like, we've all been together for so long that anyone who comes in, it's kind of going to be tough.
Kenny's a nice guy. None of us have any ill will towards him at all. He's a really nice guy. He just didn't fit with us as people.
Yeah.
But he's a nice guy, you know. I would happily speak to him in the street and like go for a pint with him or whatever. Yeah, but like, it just it didn't work out. We weren't on the same page with the levels of, you know, just dedication.
Yeah, we're
and
incredibly like, committed us for, you know what I mean?
He's a good guy, and it just, you know, so we did a few shows with Kenny right before lockdown, and then we went through kind of the first lockdown and stuff, obviously not really doing anything. Connection Lost was supposed to come out, I think the original release, it was the 1st of May 2020, and we...
I guess I got it down as spring of 2020.
Yeah, so then we pushed it back, because, you know, lockdown happened, and at first they were like, oh, it's going to be 3 weeks, so we're like, okay, we'll push it back. Push it back from May to, you know, end of July. You know, we thought like 3 weeks, so we pushed it back from the start of May to the end of July, thinking this is all going to be well long gone before then. And then, well, you know, the rest is fucking history, as they say.
Yeah.
So then we ended up releasing it 24th of July, I think. I'm the dates guy in the band, but I'm now doubting myself. I think we released the 24th of July. It was incredibly fucking frustrating because we'd spent a lot of time, a lot of money, and you know, to anybody who doesn't know about the band or whatever, on Connection Lost we had Phil Demmel, who was ex Machine Head violins guitarist. We had Joey Radziville from Sacred Rife playing guest solos and stuff. So we were really excited that that album could do a lot for us and like could really push our name and stuff, especially those guys guesting on it. And you know, at the time, what was our strongest material and stuff, so we were really excited about it. And obviously people had pre-ordered it, and the 1st of May came and we're like, okay. So we had to, you know, email all those people and tell them, oh, sorry, your pre-order is going to be a bit delayed because the place we were getting the CDs made and stuff was closed because of COVID. So when we had the opportunity to release it in July, we're like, okay, we need to fucking do it because people have already paid for it, you know what I mean? Like, they'd already, because they pre-ordered, they'd already paid for it and stuff. But then we couldn't play any shows to promote it, which fucking sucked a giant dick.
And the thing is, it's like, your interest in the album as well, you lose your interest, you know, do you know what I mean? It's like everyone's
we were super proud of it, and
really
then we were
proud
like,
of it, but the thing is, you know,
you couldn't be a band.
No. Couldn't be a band. You're going through a difficult time. I mentioned a minute ago, like the brotherhood side of things. You know, you're losing connection. We did.
That must have been hard.
Yeah, we did like Skype calls and things like that to keep in touch. Me and Drew talk all the time anyway. But yeah, I mean, you want to see each other. You know, you want to hang out. You know, and it's like it was real tough. But not to jump too far ahead. But me and Drew do what we always do, which is we write riffs
and we bounce them back
and we share them and we start writing. And that's what kept us going.
I think like we started writing Relicta. Possibly even before Connection Lost was even out, because it was already postponed, so we just started bouncing ideas back and forward. So we started working on Relicta, and we were like, okay, we'll push this forward. And so the next thing that really happened, timeline wise, was Relicta was written, recorded, and actually I think mixed as well. And we had a sort of delayed album launch slash first metal gig back in Scotland post-COVID, so they changed the restrictions like some point in May 2021 to say that you could have up to 100 people indoors seated.
Yeah.
And I was like, right, fuck it, that's happening, we're booking a show. So I booked out Church in Dundee, put together a lineup sort of pretty hastily.
Is that the one with Volcano X?
Volcano X and Immortal
Woman,
yeah. And so I think I announced the show, and within 6 or 7 days it sold out, which for Dundee is like a fucking Christmas miracle. But you know, at that point there'd be no gigs for like, it was like 60 months or something like that, it was 14 months, whatever. There'd be no gigs in Scotland, like no gigs at all, but certainly no metal gigs, you know? And so yeah, it sold out super fast. We played that show with Kenny, and we had all these new songs at that point, and we didn't want to play them because we hadn't even played all the shit off the album yet. So we kind of treated that as like a delayed album launch. You know, we did like a longer set, played for an hour or something, which was the worst decision we've ever made. We're too old and too unfit for that. But it was a sick show, and you know, it was really cool, and the reception was unbelievable. Considering everybody was seated, so we were a bit apprehensive about what it was going to be like. It was genuinely one of the most fun shows ever. I think especially because we were like, basically, fuck you, COVID.
Yeah, you got, remember, 2 years of just being
and like, and we were like proper bending the rules. Like, it was all within the rules, but it was like pushing them
stretching
to like the absolute limit. Like, you know,
it was awesome.
Like,
man.
We were like the 100 people indoors at an event. like included the staff and stuff, we were like fucking dead on 100, you know. I'd worked out who was in the bands, how many people it was, I'd checked how many bar staff there was going to be, it was like dead to the limit, it was like as busy as it could possibly be, and like, it was awesome, you know. I like to get a sold out show in Dundee is just, it's like unheard of, you know. You're talking like, going back to times like 2012 and bands like Chimera and Black Dahlia played in Dundee for the last kind of sold out metal shows, it just doesn't really happen. And obviously like, it was reduced capacity and stuff, so we're not like fucking stadium band that sold out the Hydro or whatever, you know, we sold out fucking 80 tickets seated for a social disc, but like still something to be super proud of, and personally proud of as well.
There was an element, of course, people just wanted something to
do. Oh yeah, they would have got to see any old shit.
But when people were showing up, the Catalysis t-shirts and stuff, people that we knew, it kind of like, if you think about bringing in the majority of the people that we see at shows, be it Edinburgh, Glasgow, Dundee, Perth, wherever,
all of them showed up to that show.
You know, so really, you could probably say there was, you know, at least half of the people there were fans, which is really good.
And then, so I guess like kind of, not steer the interview, because obviously that's your job, but like I guess kind of moving on from there, like I say, we already had the Relicta songs, they were already written, I can't remember if they were like fully mixed or whether like Mendel just started mixing them, but we definitely had them and we were ready to play them live,
Sure.
But we made the decision to not play them live at that show, so it was coming up to like sort of set the release date for Relicta. And we're like rehearsing and whatever, getting ready for the release show. You know, once restrictions kind of wound down over summer and stuff, we're going to have the release in September. And things just like, that was when it kind of became clear that things really weren't working with Kenny, because we were like I say, he's a good guy and a great player, but we were asking him every week to make sure he learned the new stuff like properly, and he was having to show him the same parts each week and stuff, and it just wasn't really working. And like Sean said, he didn't really ever gel into the group. And like I say, nothing against him, he is a nice guy, but it just wasn't working. So I messaged Pabs, who's our bass player now.
It's worth pointing out that when the whole thing with Kenny Point fell apart, I messaged Drew and I was like, you got anyone in mind? He's like, I've got someone in mind. I was like, I've got someone in mind as well. He's like, so Pabs. I was like, yes, man.
Yeah, so what I did was, I'd already spoken to Pabs previously, because he plays drums too, about like maybe doing a kind of death metal thing with me.
Yeah.
And he was well up for it. So I thought, I'm gonna message him, and I just asked him, hey man, would you ever be up for playing bass in a band? But I didn't say like specifically Catalysis. I was like, you know, just because we'd already spoken about playing drums in like maybe another project or whatever, and he was like, yeah, I'd be into that. So I went to the band, spoke to Sean, we all spoke and we agreed that like we should ask him if he'd be interested in playing for us. We asked him and he was like, damn fucking right, like I'm well into it. So it kind of happened like overnight, and before you knew it, Pabs was there. We did the video for A New Way to Die, which was like the sort of lead single off Relicta. And that was just after
the one that's starting off in the forest.
In the woods,
got cold half naked,
And then he's like running through the woods, you know, tracing his steps and grabbing his body.
We were trying to do something a bit different with that, because we've got like Connection Lost, Devils, etc. They're all like performance videos.
Yeah.
So we're trying something different, and Cole had this idea of the story mode. So we spoke to our good friend Andrew at A Design, and he was on board, so we put that video out.
So what I was going to say about the video was that Pabs, we'd already spoken to Pabs, and Pabs had agreed, and we were all happy he was going to be in the band. But at the point we were shooting that video, he was actually on holiday.
Yeah.
So on bass in the video was actually our friend Paul, who was the original guitar player in the band before Sean.
Right.
So me and Paul previously played an Excellent Cadaver together, and Sean played bass for Excellent Cadaver. So like, Paul's like a mutual friend of everybody in the band, everybody gets on really well, and we know he's a good player, so he learned a song in like a day just to be in the video, because he didn't have to learn it amazingly, because it's just to be in the video, you know? The conversation was, do we just not have a bassist in the video?
Yeah.
Or do we get someone in? And it just made sense to get Paul in because he was originally part of the band, and he's a good friend of everybody in the band and stuff, you know, so...
It's all a logical choice, wasn't it? Because you don't feel like you're dragging someone else in that's not part of the Catalysis family.
Yeah, he wrote some of the first EP.
Yeah, he's
a bit of the first EP.
Absolutely, yeah.
We do.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, you got any questions?
I've actually got quite a few. Now, going back to Connection Lost.
Yes, man.
You're saying a couple of guest appearances.
Yeah, yeah.
How the hell did you get them to appear? Because seriously. So that's some amazing work you got.
So, Phil Demmel, going way back to like 2011, me and my ex-girlfriend went to all the shows on the Machine Head Arena tour, and like their photographer spotted us every night, and then at the end of the tour he like took us aside and we got given like a flag and whatever, like at that, you know, one of Dave McLean's symbols signed by the band and stuff.
Yeah.
And a little bit later Phil came up as a suggested friend for me on Facebook, so I just sent him a message and was like, hey man, don't want to be a stalker, don't want to bother you at that, but I just want to say it was me that got that signed symbol and stuff, and I really appreciate it. It was really cool that you guys recognised us. And he was like, oh, no bother, you know, are you coming to any shows anytime soon? And I was like, well, I was thinking about going to the show in Dublin. So he was like, oh, well, I'll put you on the guest list. So we went to the show in Dublin, we met him outside the venue, you know, we were speaking for a little bit and stuff. And then a year later, he was doing a guitar clinic in Glasgow, so it's like 2013. And he did the, so he did the clinic, and I went along to the clinic, and at the time I was manager for Rock and Roll Tattoo.
Mm-hmm.
And Phil came along to the studio and, you know, posed for some pictures in the studio and stuff, which is good PR. And then a year later than that, in 2014, they were playing in Edinburgh. They did like the sort of intimate venues tour, and they did the Liquid Room show. And so I reached out to Phil and was like, you know how you came to the studio before, do you want to get tattooed this time? And so the whole band ended up coming and getting tattooed. Which was fucking mind-blowing for me, because I've got Phil's face tattooed here. Like, you know, so after that, you know, that day went to the show in the Liquid Rooms, and I, like, they had me backstage after the show and I was hanging out and stuff, and from there I became really good friends with Jared, Phil and Dave, and I went to like 40 shows or so, and like most of them I ended up with at Access All Areas. Like, we even went to Phil's final show in California when he left. Yeah, me and my, at the time, girlfriend at the time, now wife. Like, we flew over to California for 2 days for the final show, and then I think it really all kind of came to a head when we flew over to Belgium to see Violence at Alcatraz Festival, which is obviously the first time ever in Europe, and that's obviously the band Phil sort of started after leaving Machine Head. And we were just, you know, had a few drinks and stuff, we were chatting, and he was like, oh, I've got a guitar clinic thing coming up, do you want to play a song with me at it? And I was like, I mean, I'm obviously going to say yes, but I was like, he was like, we'll do Killers and Kings, and I was shitting myself because I didn't think I could.
Was that the guitar?
Yeah, and I didn't think I could play Killers and Kings, and it was a fucking struggle to learn. It's like, it was like proper at the edge of my limits as a guitar player, but I was like, he's my guitar hero, so I was like, well, obviously, if he asked me to play a song with him, I will fucking do anything to make it happen.
Yeah,
you know,
one shot, really.
Yeah, exactly. So,
yeah, man.
So, anyway, like, you know, after that, it was like, okay. I've played a song with him now, so I'm just going to ask him. So I just basically, I messaged him on WhatsApp and said,
yeah,
would you do a guest solo? And he was like, yeah, absolutely. So
don't ask, don't get.
Yeah, well, exactly. And like, I have a thing with that. Like, I don't like that. Like, I know quite a few people that are like big names or whatever, and it's shit. Cause, like, I don't ever want to be that guy. It's like, can I get guest this? Can I get this? You know,
yeah,
like,
yeah.
So I really, like, I swithered on it for a long time, but I was like, fuck it. Like, if he says no, it'll be cool.
But Phil was asked out of like pure respect. Do you know
what
I mean?
Yeah, like, you, like, I have his face on my fucking arm.
There's absolutely nothing to do with if he's on the album.
Yeah,
imagine
it was
how
like,
good that's going
to
be for like press. Nothing
it was
to do with
just
that.
Like, he is my all-time favorite guitar player. So like,
we went to when we went to the clinic and you played with him. Like, we were with Phil, and we were just talking about it beforehand in the car drive through. We were like, should we ask Phil? See if we'll play the solo on the guitar. We're like, yeah, let's ask him. And we got out, we went out for dinner and that, and we were just like,
we bottled it.
Total bottled it.
So I had to send him a WhatsApp.
Yeah,
and but yeah, so
complete
basically,
respect. It's just complete respect.
Literally, though, the story is, you know, I guess like that's probably like a lot of pointless backstory. I asked him and he said yes.
I tell you
what,
the
short version.
I tell you one thing. Phil was the fucking nicest guy in metal.
He is bona fide fucking legend.
He's exactly, he's just a dude, eh? He's
yep.
and then
Joey, kind of same story. So like, I didn't really, Joey's young. Joey's only been in Sacred Reich for a couple of years. He's like 24 and the rest of the guys in the band are well into their 50s, you know?
Yeah.
But when we played with them in Glasgow, I was like, that was like when we were writing and stuff for the album, I think most of it was written, but there was a couple of songs that I hadn't got around to writing the solos for yet, because usually the solos are one of the last things to get done, you know?
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, fuck writing a solo for this song. Hey, Joey, do you want to play some? Because in Sacred Wreck, he plays rhythm. Yeah. But Dave, the drummer, was like, oh, Joey's a fucking killer lead player. Like, yeah, and I was like, right, okay. Joey, do you want to play a solo? And he was like, yeah, man, I'll do it. So that was literally it. And like, sent it to me via Dropbox like a week later, and that was it, and it's a fucking ripping
solo.
Both the solos are great. Makes me feel really shit. It's like, there's these two great solos on that album, neither of them are me.
When Phil did his solo on that, we were like, oh, we'll ask Phil, we'll just shred something out of the thing. And at the time, Phil had just got his like Pro Tools ready.
He was learning it.
Yeah. So when he sent this, rather than just sending us like the DI for the solo, he sent us the project. Man, he put a lot of time into that.
Yeah, a lot of work.
The amount of, like, there's so much like admiration for him and appreciation for like the amount of time he put into like making that what it was.
Yeah.
And as Drew says, fucking
it is the most Phil demo solo in the world. Like, it has every one of his like signature things in it, you know?
It's got loads of
phase flange, it's got fucking the Flight Rose stuff, his playing through it.
He's a total legend. So amazing.
It's like a greatest hits of his solos.
And a song that I wrote,
and I'm like,
and obviously, like, Phil's got the history behind him, so, you know, you talk about him a lot, but Joey, at the end of the day, is a real support for us, you know? Like,
yeah.
It was awesome to have him on as well, right?
After we played with him, both great guys.
Such a lovely guy.
Now, the Connection Lost album has received a lot of great reviews internationally.
Mm-hmm.
Now, is there any one particular track that you're particularly fond of?
I mean, we still play the title track, Connection Lost.
Mm-hmm.
I think what happened was, so Connection Lost is a strange one. To be honest, we were writing.
We nearly killed each other over that.
Yeah. Connection Lost is a strange one because we were hovering between an EP or an album. There was enough material for an album, but me and Drew, like, you know, we're the main songwriters, so we're on each other all the time for material. And I think the album for what it is, we're proud of it, aren't we? Yeah, we're happy with the songs, absolutely. But I think when we look back on it, we probably would say that, I don't want to say anything out of turn, we were happy with it, basically.
Yeah, but, I think like we possibly could have put out an EP of like the six strongest songs on the album.
Yeah, I'd agree, yeah.
But it is what it is. Yeah. Like, it's what we wanted to do at the time, and it's like, it's a tick on the bucket list. It's full length and whatever, because like, my previous band has done full lengths and stuff, but it's a good thing to have, and it's a good thing to say you've done.
There's not one song that we can say, nah, we should have left it off. We're happy with them all, do you know what I mean? But no, in terms of tracks, Connection Lost is probably the one we play the most.
Devils in the Panic Room, that's been our live opener for a long time.
That's obviously one of the favourite band tracks, Devils, you know, the Connection Lost, and then...
We can't see either of those two leaving the set anytime soon.
It's getting more and more difficult. And the fast, flashy one, what's that called?
Tune for the Torn.
Tune for the Torn. That's a cool one.
We played that live once at the Social Distance Show.
But no, in terms of the album, no, I probably maybe sold that, you know, sold a short on that. We're really happy, it's a quality album.
But yeah, Devils in the Panic Room, Connection Lost, and it's running in my head as well.
Put it this way, when you listen to Relicta and what we're doing now, there's certain songs you can pick out of Connection Lost that sound like us, and other songs that you can tell that we were experimenting where we wanted to go with other, you know, just trying other things.
Yeah.
So when you listen to, like, Relicta was basically, this is what we've done on Connection Lost, this is what we like, and here's Relicta.
And here's a more focused,
you know,
like, shorter version.
Yeah, for sure.
Now, I watched a documentary about the making of Connection Lost. Was it called Lost Connection?
That's the one, man.
You produced that yourself.
I did, I produced it.
Now, where did the idea for making a documentary about it come from?
Chimera.
Yeah, basically, you know...
We're massive.
Our collective favourite band is Chimera.
Yeah,
like, Chimera. I really love, brackets D, Machine Head. And Sean really loves like In Flames and black metal stuff, but our like proper common ground that we properly bond over is Chimera.
Yeah,
and there's so much fucking Chimera worship in our music. Like, they could totally sue us. They have the fucking best like kind of behind the scenes studio documentaries,
yeah.
The kind of retrospective stuff and that. And both of us kind of grew up in our late teens and stuff watching those and loved it, so I think it was like very much inspired by those.
Yeah, absolutely. And hope you liked it.
I don't know, it's actually a really, really interesting watch.
Well, maybe from the watch, you know, if people want to check it out on YouTube, but you can tell from probably the documentary that we were in a really strange place at the time, right?
Well, that's actually one of my notes that I've written down is, yeah, it gave me a good insight into the band,
yeah,
and all the difficulties that you went through recording that. You know,
that's just me and Sean are up here a fucking
tossing bits back and forward, and maybe something was a
bit. That's all right.
I'll tell you something, we've never done that since,
man. No.
We've learned from our mistakes, yeah, on that.
We've got high standards, of course, of what we want, but I think Connection Lost, because it was the album, we maybe put more pressure on ourselves for it to be a particular, yeah, way. Whereas I think if we had just sat back and went, that's a fucking badass riff, that drum track's badass, do you know what Callum's put together is awesome, Cole's lyrics are awesome. We just pulled everything apart because we were like, this is the album, is this? And I think we probably maybe just, Relicta for instance, is just everyone, their input, everything sounds good, let's put it out. Whereas I think Connection Lost was maybe way overproduced, maybe.
I also think Connection Lost had a definite, there was your songs, there was my songs, and there was the songs we worked on together.
Yeah.
Whereas both Relicta and the new EP are completely collaborative. Yeah. There's not a single song on there that doesn't have some input from both of, yeah, us. Whereas on the album, there's definitely songs that I wrote and was like, here's the song.
Yeah.
And there were songs that you wrote and you're like, here's the song, and the only thing I contributed was solos, yeah, or whatever, but you, yeah, you know what I mean? So
I think in terms of the collaborative side of things, it was one of the most collaborative moments we've had, but you only got a certain amount of songs for that. And being completely honest, it got to the point where we were happy with the songs, but we were like, do you know what? That'll do. But there's not a song that you listen to that I'm disappointed with, or I think there's any less than anything else. It's just, I think you watch a documentary, you can tell that, and then and this is what we were saying earlier on, is then when the whole pandemic happened and it came out, we were just done. The mixes, man. We must have listened to the mixes on one of the mixes because there were so many songs.
There's something wrong in that guitar on the left. No, there's not.
I see the guitar on the left. There's a noise. You're playing something a bit different. Oh no. It was just. We've learned massively.
It was the only time in years of being friends that we've come close to falling out. We were properly at each other's throats about stuff, and it was shit.
I was right, but Jude's fucking stupid.
Now, if you haven't seen it, I strongly suggest you watch it. It's called Lost Connection. It's on YouTube. It is a brilliant watch. Now, there was a section in the documentary that made me laugh about. And that's the little doodle that you gave your artist for the...
my shitty drawing?
It was like a little biro drawing on a piece of paper. You hand it over to your artist and he come out with this amazing piece of artwork.
The thing is, when you're talking artwork, when you're talking mixes or anything, with a band our size, you don't have the luxury of being able to sit with them, go over hundreds of ideas, being backed financially by someone else. The bottom line is, you come up with an idea, you put it to someone and you just hope they grasp.
Yeah, we don't have an unlimited pot of money, you know. We have a very limited pot of money, as it turns out, so buy our fucking CDs. that guy, I scoured high and low, and actually, very, very depressingly, I really wanted to work with Cokie Greenway, who's the artist who's done loads of stuff for Aborted and bands like that, Black Dahlia. He's basically any metal band you can think of, he's done a t-shirt for them. And I mailed him, didn't hear fucking anything back, and 2 days after we agreed and paid the fee to the guy who did the artwork, that guy got back to me and I was like, the artwork was killer. He took the concept. My art call was remember what it was. Like, shitty crayon sketch thing. And did a really good job with it.
Yeah.
But I don't remember that being the documentary. I've not watched it in fucking ages.
It's in the documentary, yeah.
I watched the documentary when you first put it out, and then obviously with this interview coming up, watch it again.
That's really awesome. Just wrap up. Really awesome. Yeah, it's really awesome that you took the time to watch it again.
I thought it was really well done. It was very professional.
I appreciate that. Thanks.
Now, the follow-up EP to 2020's Connection Lost, as you said, was Relicta. Right. Now, how long did you start recording Relicta after you finished playing?
Instantly. Yes. So basically,
we write all the time. You got to remember that. When you look at our output compared to other local bands.
And that's not meant to be a brag,
we write all the time, so we enjoy doing it.
So we did 2017 we released Into Unknown, 2018 we released the self-titled EP,
Yeah.
2019, we didn't release anything, but that's we released Just Turn Back as a single, but like we were focused on like trying out the Metal to Masses thing and like playing in Europe and stuff.
Yeah.
But we started recording Connection Lost, but obviously because it's an album, it takes longer to do. It costs more money, so you need to spend more time saving and stuff. So you know, so 2017, 2018, 2020, Connection Lost, 2021, Relicta, and now 2022, Innova. So like you're talking.
We're
very consistent.
Yeah,
there's not many local bands that put out as much stuff as we do.
What did you do differently in Relicta that you'd done on Connection?
We sat in the same room and
recorded. Chill out a bit. Like, the thing is, like, Relicta to us is like, fuck, Connection Lost is a fucking nightmare. Mm-hmm. Let's just get together, let's riff out, here's some ideas I've got, here's some ideas you've got, and like, Relicta to us is the one that we look at and we think, do you know, that's really us, you know?
And I think, like, what happened a lot with Relicta was, like, you'd have a sort of, like, 6 out of 10 song, and I'd have a 6 out of 10 song, we'd get together, and, like, we'd put a little bit of my special sauce on your songs, and your special sauce on my songs, and it, like, elevated them from being, like, alright, decent, you know, decent songs, to being really fucking good.
And if we're fair, when you look at Connection Lost, like sometimes Drew would be like, check this riff, and I'd be like, yeah, that's cool, and then obviously I just record it, because I would demo a lot of stuff, and then be like, yeah, that's cool, and then because there was so much material, let's move on to the next song, that we should have revisited some of the other, like every time there was a change made, you should really revisit it, which we didn't, whereas Relicta, we just continued. I talked about being overproduced on Connection Lost, which that went a bit far, but Relicta was like, me and Drew, heads together, this is what we want to be. We went to the practice space, Callum was brought in, let's do the drums properly, none of this program shit. We sat in the room, the three of us, we went over everything together. You know, we made sure everything was tight. In terms of bass, Cole, this was the time where Cole was sort of like, not sure what was happening.
Nah, he was already off bass.
He was off bass. So basically, the three of us.
It was just me, you and Callum.
Yeah, we just really concentrated on what we wanted to do. So yeah.
Awesome. Now, fast forward to early on this year, you announced that you was going to be playing Metal to the Masses.
Mm-hmm.
Now, on my radio show, there was a few certain bands that I was referring to as the Metal to the Masses alumni. You being one of them, because obviously finalists in 2019, you know, he's coming back to it, he was obviously going to be one of the favourites. Now, how did you feel going into this year's competition as opposed to 2019?
First things first, I was against it. I was like,
yeah,
honest.
So I think like it's a battle of the bands thing, and there's always like some stigma that comes with battle of the bands.
Yeah.
And we kind of debated should we, shouldn't we, and so we had fuck all booked because of the pandemic, and like, you know, even just after Christmas we had that sort of mini lockdown, not quite a lockdown, but all the gigs got cancelled and that, so like we didn't have anything booked, and because I do all the booking for the band, I was like, fuck this, I'm not booking stuff because it's too much of a headache, because you book it, it gets cancelled, you move it, it gets cancelled, so I was like, fuck this. So we were kind of like, okay, we don't necessarily want to do Metal for Masses from the point of view of it being a battle of the bands and all the rest of it, but we also have no shows, we've not fucking played live for a really long time, and it would be sick to just do some shows.
Yeah, yeah.
So we're like, fuck it, we'll enter it, because bottom line, you're guaranteed at least one show out of it, right? You get the first heat, that's a given. And like, without being arrogant, we were fairly confident we'd get through the heats. Like, we didn't think we'd get to the final, we didn't think we'd win, you know what I mean? But we're like, we'll probably get two gigs out of this at least.
Because the first heat, that was you, Volcano X, Hyperstasis,
and Colonel Fist.
Colonel Fist, that's right.
Well, it was,
and it was you and Volcano X that went through, weren't it?
Yeah, Volcano X, they're good, obviously, local buddies of ours, great band.
Yeah,
play with them a lot of the time, so it was good that we both got through, you know?
Now, on the night of the final itself, how did you feel going into the competition?
Like certain death were going to put us out.
I personally, without sounding too big-headed, I was quite confident. We had, like, you know, we played so many heats, and you've got to start like
believing in yourself.
Hype.
Yeah.
You know, like we would come off stage tonight, and you always get great feedback. People tell you, you know, and we're really hard on ourselves.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
I am the most critical.
Yeah, we are really critical. So, and it's got to get to the point where it's like, you know what? Maybe we are better than what we think.
Like,
you know?
Enough people are saying that we're good that maybe we're not as shit as we think we are. You know
so
I mean?
We went into the final, like, certain death are in, but we're going to fucking send it like we always
We went in saying we're going to give it 100%, and basically, we like every band in the final, we wanted to win, but we were like, if we lose, so be it, and if we lose to certain death, there's no shame in that.
Yeah.
Those guys are tight as fuck, they've been at it a long time, they've played big festivals and stuff before. Yeah. The guitar player's in The Exploited, or was in The Exploited, he's in a band with Billy from Biohazard, you know, so like, there's no shame in losing to guys like that.
But we were confident, man, I must admit, that we were confident.
Not overconfident, but
we were confident that we would put on a good show, and we were confident that it would go down well, we just thought we were up against some tough.
Yeah, there was, like I said before, there were a few bands that I was saying from the start of the competition, you know, they're capable of winning it. You were one of the guys.
A lot of people we know that have been in, sort of involved in the metal scene in Scotland and stuff were telling us the same thing, but I like to, my philosophy in life is, think everything's going to be shit, because then if it's shit, it doesn't disappoint you. You know, if you're like, oh, I'm entering this competition, I'm going to fucking win, and you get put out, and you're going to be gutted. You go in thinking like, well, we're not going to win, like, take what it is, you know. So I went in with low expectations.
I didn't. I went in with fucking. I'm always honest, man. Like, I was probably the most confident. We fucking work our ass off in this band, man. Do you know what I mean? Like, we work hard. We put out a lot of material. We work really hard. You know, I went into it thinking,
we have a good chance.
Yeah, we've got a really good chance here. Like, we're a band, you know, we're...
Plus Simon already knew who we were. He'd seen us before in the final.
Yeah.
And he saw us as a four-piece. And anybody who saw us as a four-piece and has since seen us as a five-piece, whether that be a five-piece with Kenny or a five-piece with Pabs, will tell you that we are better live now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
You're a much bigger oiled machine now than you were 2 years ago.
Mm, that's good to hear.
You know, it's... There's more of a crunch, like a fuller.
I agree.
You know, but see on the night, if you could describe how you felt after your name got called out as winners.
It's fucking awesome.
how would you describe that feeling?
So when Simon announced it, he went up and he said, he basically said that it's his decision regarding band to play. So there was going to be two bands that were going to get to play Bloodstock. He said, there's only going to be one winner tonight, but he makes a decision. So, and it was awesome to hear because we're friends with them. We know them like Certain Death. But like, they got announced first as the band that would play the Jägermeister stage.
Yeah.
And we were stoked. And then you start to think, well, they were the front runners. Like, so what does that mean? And he was like, so there's only one winner tonight, you know, and that band is, oh man.
Yeah, that 20 seconds, you're like.
Oh, you fucker, just say it! He's like, get
off.
I don't even think he said Catalysis.
I
think he said,
and we're like, right! Oh,
that's
the
game with
the
seat. We'll have a drink, and I don't know where that ended up. I had a pint that went somewhere. But do you know what, man? It's like, it was like this massive relief of just so much hard work.
Yeah, it's the gratification of it all. Like, you know, like Sean said, we put a lot of time, a lot of effort, a lot of money. I don't mean that we're loaded, that's not, you know, it's fucking expensive.
And we don't think other bands don't do the same, you know, but you know, the sacrifices we have to make as well, like as a band, you know, not to go into that, but it's like, to me, it's like that moment was this massive relief, it was amazing.
Relief and reward, yeah.
Relief and reward, yeah, man, absolutely.
Right, now when you woke up the following morning, how did it begin to sink in yet?
Well, we kind of like, because we got home quite late, we were sort of messaging, you know, well done guys, yeah, fuck yeah, dude, awesome. You know, but I think
it's only really going to properly sink in when we step out on the stage. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, at Bloodstock, I think that's when it's going to really
I think, don't take this the wrong way, but like, the gig's a gig, we're concentrating on the fact that we are performing at this venue, like tonight we're performing at this other venue. We're concentrating on putting the best show on we can.
Yeah, like any gig, we put 100% in. Yeah. If you know, we played shows in like Arbroath, which is, you know, bumfuck nowhere, Angus, in like a place that's a fucking family restaurant that's got like an all day thing with bands on, and we fucking played with just a vocal PA set up in the corner to like 20 people who were fucking eating fish suppers and that. Like, a gig is a gig, and we will put in the same effort to those shows as we will to Bloodstock.
20 or 20,000, didn't it?
Yeah.
Right, now, during all of this time, right, you've played some memorable gigs. Are there any particular ones that stick out in your mind? Was it the any from the tour?
He's going to say the same as me. He'll say the same as me. I don't even need to say it.
Right, on the count of three, okay? 1, 2, 3.
Sacred Reich.
And why does that stick out?
So obviously, like you said before, Sean and I, both huge Machine Head fans growing up and whatever. Dave left Machine Head, which is, you know, is what it is, and it makes a bit of sense. And we got asked onto that show. Mm. Like, they asked for us.
That's an honor.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. And, you know, so Callum, our drummer, I've got a portrait of Phil here.
Yeah.
Callum's got a portrait of Dave McLean on his leg. Really? And so we were playing in the Cat House, which is obviously a legendary Glasgow venue.
Yeah.
With Sacred Reich, legendary thrash band.
That was actually a really good gig.
And then,
did you were there?
I actually missed that one, but I watched it on YouTube.
That's cool, man.
And then you know, so Callum's got Dave McLean on his leg, and while we were playing, I think like 2 or 3 songs in, I spot Dave standing at the side with his hood up, you know, just standing in the crowd. And I walked over at Callum, you know, I was like trying to get his attention while we were like mid-song. I was like, look who's watching you. And like, so he's playing a set with one of his fucking drum heroes, like one of his main influences and inspirations, watching him. And yeah, we got a great reception. It was by far, you know, one of the biggest crowds we've played to.
Do you know what I mean?
It was one of the first kind of big supports. Yeah, yeah. We played with Broken Hope before we were a big death metal band, but we were a bit like, now I think we've probably got enough super heavy stuff that we can pull together a set to be really good with death metal bands.
Yeah.
But at the time, we were maybe like not quite the right band for that bill. So Sacred Reich were on a bill with like, you know, more stuff that kind of suits us a bit. And like, so it was like, just that it was a good night, good venue. Yeah. Just the whole thing was great.
Yeah. You know, every small band's looking for that break, do you know what I mean? And it just goes to show like just how awesome, like Dave, we spoke about Phil already and everyone, and Chris as well.
Chris Green, tour manager. He was former Machine Head tour manager, so.
We're looking for that, just a little bit of help.
Oh,
you know, and they've always been supportive.
They've always been supportive.
It's the fucking Avatar slot.
Now, your new EP, Inova, that's set for release on July the 2nd.
Yep.
Was there any difference in this recording process to Relicta?
One small difference, which is that for the last few releases, I think actually possibly all of the releases we've done, we always recorded the drums last. Yeah. This time we recorded the drums first, which is
pre-production. We did a lot of
it's like the typical way of doing things is recording drums first. But what we did was we recorded all the guitars and stuff previously. Vocals, blah blah blah, all to program drums. So Callum would program the drums to be what he was going to play, we'd record everything else, and then we'd go into the studio and record the drums at the end. This time we did the drums first, but that meant that we could tweak some bits of the guitar and stuff to the nuances of Callum's playing, whereas the other way around, he was usually having to tweak stuff to what we wanted in the studio. And we worked with a different producer on the drums this time, just for the drum track, and we worked with Mark Tyndall from Dundee. He mixed the first EP into the unknown, but like we didn't really get exactly what we were looking for from him. It's a good EP and sounds good and stuff, but it wasn't exactly what we wanted. So we tracked the drums with him this time, and we spent really a fucking agonizing amount of time dialing in the drum sounds. I think we were like tuning the kit for like 4 hours, and it was fucking miserable. But the end results are much more natural.
Yeah.
So on this new EP, there's like hardly any samples on the drums and stuff, because like we're all big fans of like, you know, big fat natural tones and stuff.
Yeah. Right, now the first song from Inova to be released is Shadow Parasite.
Yes.
What's the story behind that song? Because you played that tonight.
Shadow Parasite is actually a demo I've had since 2015, I think.
Right.
But it was a bit. It needed some work, basically. So I presented it to Drew and said, yo, I've got this demo, you know what I mean? It's been around for ages, what do you think? We've spoke about it on previous Catalysis releases, but it just wasn't the right track to have. So once me and Drew decided, you know, actually, we think this might be the time, we can work with this. So yeah, we sat together, worked through it, and changed a few things here and there.
Yeah, I think like the main initial big change was like that you were like, oh, okay, the chorus needs something else. Because I had just like an octave thing in it before. And you were like, you know,
You were quite against it at first. Not against it needing it. You were just like,
I was happy with the octave thing.
And I was like, man, I know you can bring something to this. And the minute
I came up with a chorus lead thing, and then that kind of transformed it. And then from there, it's more or less kind of the same,
yeah.
But we fucked about a little bit with the structure, like making. There's a lot of like variations on a particular riff in that song, and like we kind of messed about with like making some of those heavier and some of them, you know, more thrashy and
put the breakdown at the end.
And then the end of the song originally was going to be a fade out,
right?
But there was another song on the EP with the fade out, and I was dead set against having two songs that fade out on the EP, which me and Sean kind of argued about as well. But I was like, no, we're not fucking doing two fade outs, it's lazy as fuck, you know, we need to do an ending for this. So Sean was like, fine, what about this riff? And then wrote probably the best riff on the whole EP. So
that's a cool riff.
It's cool. So you know, it worked out pretty well, but again, it came from us pushing each other. Like there was a good idea, there was a good solid foundation, like a sort of 6 out of 10 song to start with.
Yeah.
And we pushed each other on it, and like it has possibly my favourite solo I've ever recorded on it. It's like,
but the thing is, man, every release, because we write all the time, it's always like, have we done that riff before? Have we done that drum track before? We're always like looking for something new. And I think Shadow Parasite and what it was came in quite early on, and that was the one that really made us think, you know what, let's push the boundaries a little bit and go for something else.
Now, how long did the EP take to record in total?
Not long, I mean.
It's hard to say, because we do so much of it ourselves.
Yeah. If you were to boil it down into days, like, it's probably 10 days or something.
Less than that.
Less than that, 6 days.
We sat together, like 3 evenings and did all the guitars?
Yeah.
And like, you know, there was a day on the drums, and like, that's probably a few hours of pads on the vocals.
Because if
we booked out the studio to do it, it would have probably taken us like 3 or 4 days, I guess. Like,
because of pre-production, like, this is the first time. Well, we licked to maybe, but this time it was like, we walked in, it was like, there was no...
Everybody knew exactly what
there was
playing.
Like, man, you're playing that riff a bit weird. Like, it's actually here, or it's this run. Which we had previously, whereas this time it was like, we didn't even need to check. We'd already done it, we'd already done it.
Everything was dialed in.
Yeah.
For the first time ever, and it made me so much less. I'm the stressy one in the band.
Oh, well, I mean, as like I said before, you certainly sound like a well-oiled machine now.
Thanks,
you can tell that the years of playing together is really starting to show. Now, what other gigs have you got coming up, and what are the plans for the rest of the year?
So, playing this Bloodstock show or something
like that. Oh, that wee festival thing.
Yeah, apparently.
That's 12th of August. We're on the Friday. And then we've got a show in September in Edinburgh, which hasn't been announced yet. I think it's like Scotland Rocks Radio Show. And then October
live in Lowe
in Banshee, and then we've got Aberdeen in October, which is great because I think we've never actually played Aberdeen even since Col was our vocalist. So we were talking like first EP, like second or third show ever.
So
was last time
we played
Aberdeen.
What, 2016, 2017?
Late 17, I think. Yeah, it was just before Sean joined the band, I think. So a long time. So well overdue return to Aberdeen. And obviously we're still trying to book up some other stuff around the new EP coming out, but obviously with so much shit being rescheduled from the past couple of years, venue availability can be pretty scarce. We also have other problems like Carl, our singer, he works at a school, so it means that we have like limited availability to do stuff during the week because he can't just take time off, you know, which is fine. You know, family and life and work and stuff comes first because it's important. Make sure the bills are paid.
Yeah, for sure.
So we're still booking up some other stuff as well, but we've got some solid plans in for the rest of the year.
Awesome, awesome. And now, will there be any videos being released off this EP?
Yes.
Yeah, we've just done, so like I said earlier on last Sunday, we were working with Mark Sharp from Dundee Sharp. He's done Connection Lost and Devils in the Panic Room videos before. He's also done some great photography for us as well. So, and we love working with Mark, like he knows what he's doing, he's super professional. So we had a song before we'd even like thought about a video. It was always going to be the one before the fall.
It was a song I wrote, but we tweaked it a bit. We put some of your riffs in the middle of it and stuff. But like the verse riff of it, it was like as soon as we played that verse riff in the room, we were like every one of us. You know those YouTube challenges like try not to headbang shit. It was like one of those. Like as soon as we started playing it in the room, it's like this is the one to do the video for.
Yeah, nice.
So so we shot a video for Before the Fall. Last Sunday, it should be out before the EP.
Should. There was flour fucking everywhere.
Yeah.
Everyone's neck hurts. So it should be good, man. And
I thought I was talking to you about upstairs, weren't you?
Oh, mate, I tell you what, I'm going to headbang my fucking head off.
Last question, guys. You spent any new merch?
Yes, we've got the Innovate EP, we've got three new t-shirts in a range of sizes.
From small to fat man.
That's it.
So yeah, man. And this is the longest interview the Doomsday Report
has ever done.
Oh, well, I mean, it's been very informative. We've had a lot to go over because it has been a long time.
I'm bursting for a piss.
So thank you for taking the time out to chat with me.
No, man, thank you, dude. Thank
yeah,
you
yeah, thanks so much for your support.
Can I say?
And the cameraman. Thank you, dude. Your feet must be killing you.
His feet, his fucking hand. I know, like, the whole time.
I've been Esteban. This has been Catalysis. And this has been The Doomsday Report.